Welcome to my YouTube channel. Please be sure to subscribe to my channel and also do not forget to press the bell icon so you never miss any video tutorial published by me.
Hello students, welcome back to my YouTube channel Complex Biology. In today's video, we will discuss a very important topic of biochemistry which is related to pH, pKa. pKa is acid dissociation constant and pKa has some value and pI which is isoelectric point. Apart from this, we will also learn about zither ion, diprotic acids. Those are just small definitions and we will solve some problems based on pKa pI. But before we discuss this important topic, we need to understand the basic structure of amino acids because everything depends on the structure of amino acid. So let us start with understanding the basic structure. So an amino acid has carbon, main carbon. To this carbon, one acid group is attached, COH. One amino group is attached. This is acidic group. And this is amino group. This group imparts basicity to the amino acid, whereas this group imparts acidity to the amino acid. And one H is also attached. But this is the basic structure. This entire structure is there in all the amino acids. The reason why amino acids differ in chemical properties is this R group. Because this R group is different in different amino acids. And this R group decides whether an amino acid is polar, non-polar, acidic or basic. Right? So, basically these are only showing the acidity or basicity, but actually the chemical property of an amino acid depends upon its R group, so which is also known as side chain. So what exactly an amino acid will be, how exactly it will behave in a polar or non-polar solvent, that totally depends upon this R group. So I have already said this line. Amino acids are classified based on this R group. This structure, this entire structure is exactly the same in all the amino acids. That means they differ from each other because of this R group. Now let us discuss the first amino acid, which is the simplest amino acid and which is symmetrical, which is known as glycine. We denote it with GLY or even with G. It does not have any R group. That's why it is symmetrical. Symmetrical means here also there is H, here also it is H. So there is no R group. Instead of R group, there is an H. So, and this entire structure, as I have already said, this is same in all the amino acids. So R group is not there in this amino acid. So this is the simplest amino acid known as glycine. So now let us discuss asymmetrical amino acids. So basically only one amino acid, which is glycine, is symmetrical. Rest of the amino acids are asymmetrical. So this is the basic structure and here I am writing only R group for simplicity. Right? So this is also R group. Now the second category of amino acids is aliphatic amino acids. Aliphatic amino acids means the amino acids which have R group as an aliphatic chain. Aliphatic chain means a simple chain of hydrocarbon. Like hydrocarbon means it has only C and H, C and H, C and H, and no special functional group like alcoholic group which is OOH or COH or any other amino acid group, any other functional group is not there. So, and these are neither aromatic. These are simple chain of hydrocarbon. So, any amino acid which has simply a chain of hydrocarbons no special functional groups are known as aliphatic amino acids. These amino acids are hydrophobic or non-polar, like they do not dissolve in water. They dissolve in oil and all. Non-polar mediums, solutions basically. Because they are similar to them. So now first let us understand the R group of alanine. So alanine is also denoted as ALA or A. So the R group is alanine is CH3. So basically if we will remove this R group and we will attach CH3 over here, then it will become alanine. So alanine has simply alanine has CH3 only. So it is a hydrocarbon, that means it is made up of only carbon atoms and hydrogen atoms. There is no functional group like alcohol, COH, ester group, nothing. Only a simple chain of carbon and hydrogen. Now the third one, first one was glycine, second one is alanine, the third amino acid is valine, or it is also denoted as val or V or V. So the R group is CH3, CH2, CH3. So basically if we will attach it over here, then it will become valine. Now the fourth amino acid, aliphatic amino acid, is leucine or LEU or L. We denote it as LEU or L. So the R group is CH2, CCH2. So it is slightly bigger than valine. Only one additional CH2 is over here. Now the fifth amino acid is isoleucine, or we denote it as ILE or I. So the structure is CH3, CH2, C, and one CH3 is attached over here. So basically we will attach this R group over here, then it will become isoleucine. So that was about aliphatic amino acids, which are hydrophobic or non-polar. Now let us understand about other amino acids with functional group. Now let us understand the structure and chemical properties of hydroxyl group containing amino acids. Hydroxyl group means alcoholic group, that means OH group, which is polar in nature. Polar in the sense it has charges. So that means it is charged group. So the sixth amino acid is serine, which has the structure like this. So an OH group is attached. So basically if we will attach this R group over here, this amino acid will become serine. Now threonine is another hydroxyl group containing amino acid. So structure is same, with the only difference that we have CHT over here rather than having H. Otherwise the other things in the structure is same. So now it has an additional CH3. So I remember these amino acids as, because S come in the letters, S comes before T. So I remember it like that. So S1 is simpler and this one is more. So these are polar because of the presence of OH group. That means hydrophilic. That means these have charge. So these can dissolve in water. Sulfur containing amino acids are cysteine. We denote them as CYS or C. So it has SH over here. Rather than having OH, it has SH over here. Now this is methionine. So it is a straight chain with S group over here. This is also known as thioether group. Wherever we can see a sulfur instead of O, like we know that ether bond is ROR. But here we have R. These groups are represented as R, S, R. So that means it is not ether group now. This is thioether group now. wherever we see sulfur, if there is any thio s prefix, then that means it has sulfur in it. Now we can remember this structure as like, if we talk about sulfur containing amino acids, we know that C comes first in the letters, then M comes. That means C is simpler and methionine is larger. So we can remember the structure like this, because sometimes we get confused that whether this is methionine or this is methionine. So we can remember that C comes first in the letters, so that's why the simpler one is cysteine and the complex one is methionine. So both are hydrophobic and uncharged. Like OH group, this group, SH group is not charged. So both are uncharged. That means they won't dissolve in water. They are hydrophobic. Hydrophobic in the sense it will dissolve in non-polar solvents. Like benzene. So we discussed 9 amino acids. Now let us discuss about other amino acids. Now let us discuss acidic amino acids and their amides. So the first, basically this is aspartic acid and this is glutamic acid, and this asparagine is derived from aspartic acid. That's why it is known as a derivative of aspartic acid. And this glutamine is derived from glutamic acid. So that's why it is known as a derivative of glutamic acid. Now since aspartic acid has COH group, as already said, COH group is known for is known to impart acidic character to a chemical structure. So that's why aspartic acid is acidic in nature. Basically both these acids, amino acids, are negatively charged and polar in nature. So now this is the main carbon, and to this carbon this R group is attached. So this main carbon C is known as alpha carbon. Now this, since it will be attached over here, so this will be beta carbon. So that means here in aspartic acid, acidic group is attached to the beta carbon, right? So this is the structure of aspartic acid, CH2COH. Now glutamic acid, when it comes to glutamic acid, it is denoted as D, and this is denoted as E, because we can't denote it with A, because A has already been given to alanine. So we denote it as D. Now glutamic acid has like beta carbon, gamma carbon, and then to gamma carbon, this is alpha, then this is beta, and this is gamma carbon. So an acidic group is attached to the gamma carbon, right? So what will be the structure? Let me show you the structure over here. So like if we want to make it as aspartic acid, then we will attach CH2 over here and then COH. So this is alpha carbon, this is beta carbon, and to this beta carbon COH is attached. Now if we want to make it glutamic acid, then we will attach one more CH2 over here and then we will attach COH. So beta, this is gamma. So the acidic group is attached to the gamma carbon, right? So that's how, if anywhere beta is written, that means to beta carbon a functional group is attached. Now asparagine is derived from aspartic acid itself, so and it is denoted as N. So it is an amide group is C double bond O NH2. So from OH it has already C double bond over here, but this OH group has been removed and NH2 has been attached over here. So now it is basically CONH2, but it is COH. That's why when we remove OH from here and we attach amine group over here, after removing alcoholic group, then it becomes asparagine. That means an amide. This is an amide group. CONH2 is an amide group. Similarly, glutamic acid also has this derivative which is known as glutamine. So to glutamine we have NH2 attached over here. After removing OH from here, we attach NH2. We can also write it as C double bond over OH. Now if we will remove OH from here and we will attach NH2 over here, then it will become an amide. So that's how glutamine is derived from glutamic acid. So it is the derivative. This entire group is amide group. So that's about acidic amino acids which are negatively charged. And let me show you how it will become negatively charged. It has C double bond OH. Now when this it has this. Now when H will be removed, we know that H gets removed as H plus. So now only C double bond O and O negative will be left over here. Since it has negative charge, so it is known as negatively charged. Because OH has been removed, which has plus charge. So that's why these are negatively charged. Now, let us understand basic amino acids. These are acidic amino acids. Now, let us understand basic amino acids and their chemical properties. So, histidine, which is denoted as H, it has, the structure is like this. It has this ring. This entire ring is known as imidazole ring. And this imidazole ring can accept H plus ion, and it can also denote H plus ion. So that means it can work as an acid and a base at the same time. So that means it has buffering capacity. It can behave as acid by donating H plus and also as a base by accepting H plus. So and these amino acids all are positively charged and hydrophilic. That means they will dissolve in water. Now, the 15th amino acid is lysine. We denote it as LYS or K. So now, this is the structure, this entire structure, it has NH2 group attached. Now, we know that this is alpha, so this will be beta, gamma, delta, and this will be epsilon. So, it is also known as epsilon amino group. Because it is attached to the epsilon carbon. Alpha is here, beta, gamma, delta and epsilon. Right? And now, the 16th amino acid is arginine. So basically we have 3 basic amino acids and 2 acidic amino acids, which are aspartic acid and glutamic acid. Now, 16th one is arginine, which is denoted as ARG or R. So it has this guanidium ion. This structure is known as guanidium ion. Guanidium ion is attached to beta, gamma and delta carbon. Right? So, this structure is known as guanidium ion. So, all of these groups are positively charged and hydrophilic. That means they will dissolve in water. Now, we have only 4 amino acids to discuss. Right? So, 3 of them are aromatic amino acids. And last one is somewhat weird, which is known as protein. Now let us understand about aromatic amino acids. Aromatic amino acids means those amino acids which have benzene ring. So the first one is phenylalanine, which is denoted as PHE or F. It has CH2 and a benzene ring attached over here. Now similar to phenylalanine, tyrosine is also, the structure of tyrosine is also same, but it has OH group attached over here. Otherwise, the rest of the structure is same as that of phenylalanine. Now, the last aromatic amino acid is tryptophan, which is denoted as TRP or W. It has one benzene ring, then to benzene ring, one more ring is attached, and then there is CH2. When we will attach it to here, then it will become tryptophan. This is the heaviest amino acid, as we can see the structure. And all these amino acids are folded. But since tyrosine and tryptophan, tryptophan has NH over here and tyrosine has OH. So these are slightly charged. So that's why these are more hydrophilic than phenylalanine. Phenylalanine is completely hydrophobic because it does not have anything which can dissolve in water. But here it has OH group, so it can slightly dissolve in water. And indole ring has, like tryptophan has this indole ring which has NH. So it is also slightly dissolved in water. It can somewhat dissolve in water. But otherwise there, if we will see overall, they are non-polar. That means they cannot dissolve in water. Now the last amino acid, we do not call it as amino acid. It is known as amino acid because it has somewhat weird kind of structure. It is known as proline, PRO or C. Like the side chain is actually attached with the alpha carbon. Here I am making the entire structure to let you understand. This is NH2 group. This is COOH group. This is H group. And this is R group. And this R group has alpha, beta, gamma and delta. But this delta carbon is attached with the main carbon of alpha. That's why we do not call it as amino acid. This is amino acid. Because alpha carbon is attached with the side group, side chain. So this is hydrophobic in nature because it has this entire hydrocarbon chain. Just like aliphatic amino acids like alanine, valine, isoleucine. Right? So that's all about structure and chemical properties of amino acids. Now let us understand glutathione, diprotic acid and pKa, pI. And let us solve problems based on these concepts. Now let us understand what exactly a glutathione is. Basically we know that amino acid has both COH group and NH2 group. So this COH group has a tendency to lose a proton, that means H plus. After losing H plus it becomes COO negative, negatively charged, plus H plus. And it goes to the medium, to the surrounding medium like water. And this NH2 group is also there in the amino acid. This NH2 group has a tendency to accept a proton. So after accepting a proton, that means H plus, it becomes NH3 plus. This H plus comes from the medium. That means if the amino acid is in water, then water will denote donate H plus to NH2 to become NH3 plus. Now a glutathione is the one, is an amino acid or any substance which can act as both as an acid and as a base also. We know that acids are proton donors, that means they donate H plus to the medium. So this is the amino acid, this is the R group, this is any amino acid, it has COH. Once it will lose H plus, then it will become CO negative over here. And that means it has donated H plus to the medium. So it is behaving as an acid or proton donor. But the same amino acid, when it has CO negative charge and no H plus, then it can accept the H plus again. So after accepting, it will again become COH. COH over here. So now, since now it is accepting H plus rather than donating to the medium. So now it is behaving as a base, that means a proton acceptor. So this is known as glutathione amino acid. And these kind of substances which have dual nature, like they can act as both acid and base, these are also known as amphoteric substances. Now let us understand what a diprotic acid is. This is an amino acid. This NH2 has accepted H plus already. Now, first of all, this COH will donate an H plus to the medium. So it will become COO negative. Now, this is the one H plus which has been donated. Now, the same amino acid, if it will donate one more H plus to the medium from NH3 plus to become NH2, then it will it will be known as diprotic acid. That means it can donate 2H plus to the medium. So when it was like this, originally it has plus one charge because NH2 had accepted 1H plus to become NH3 plus. So it had plus one charge. Now once H plus was donated to the medium, now it became negatively charged over here, but it also had positive charge over here. So the net charge was zero. This concept is very important if we want to understand pKa and pI isoelectric point. Now this NH3 plus will donate 1H plus, so the plus charge will be gone. The H plus has been donated from here. When plus charge will be gone, then it will become negatively charged. Like plus charge is gone, so now it has one negative charge. So from positive to zero to negative charge. That's how amino acids can get charged positively or negatively in a medium. So now let us understand concept of isoelectric point, pKa values, and how exactly we can find out isoelectric points of an amino acid. Hi, so now let us understand what exactly a pKa is, what is pI, and the pKa of various side chains, that means R groups of amino acids. So pKa is basically a pH. It represents a pH at which a group is half ionized. Half ionized in the sense, like if there are 10 molecules of proper amino acid, then 10 molecules will be present in the medium as dissociated form. Like if this is an amino acid, RCH. So 10 molecules will be present in this form and 10 molecules will be present in the in this form. So 10 molecules are dissociated forms, right? So 10 plus 10 is 20. So half the molecules are present in accepted form and half are present in dissociated form. So this is known as a pKa. A pKa is basically a pH at which a group is half ionized. We will understand this better later on, but right now we only need to know this. pI is also known as isoelectric point. pI is isoelectric point. This is the pH at which the net charge on a molecule is zero. So we actually need to find it out. We will do problems based on pI. So like I explained you guys, in the diprotic acid there was a situation when the charge was zero in between. So in the same way, pI is the pH at which the net charge on a molecule is zero. Now like we have an amino acid which has a pKa. If we keep the amino acid at a higher pH than the pKa, then it will tend to lose the H plus ion. Let me tell you why. We all know that 7 is neutral pH. Right? Now, and when we go beyond 7 up to 14, like 8 to 14, it becomes basic. Any amino acid or any substance becomes basic. Now, if it will become basic, then what will happen? Base means it will accept H plus. And if the molecule will accept H plus, that means in the medium there are less H plus ions. Right. Now in the surrounding medium the H plus ions are less, but we want to maintain an equilibrium. we don't want H+. There must be an equilibrium established between the amino acid and the medium. So, since H+ ions are less, so in that case, the amino acid will lose its H+. Lose H+. So that the H+ in the medium and with the amino acids will equilibrate with each other. I hope it is clear. So when we keep it at higher pH, then it will tend to lose H+ ions. However, if we will keep the amino acid at a lower pH, then pKa of its side chain. Now what will happen? We know that lower pH is anything in between 0 to 6 or 6.99 something. Right? Now what will happen? We know that H+ are more. Acidic environment, we know more H+ are present in the medium. We know that when H+ concentration increases, acidity increases. That means in the surrounding medium, there are a lot of H+ ions. Now what exactly the amino acid will do? It wants to establish an equilibrium with the medium. So now the amino acid will have a tendency to accept the H+, so that the H+ which are more in the medium can establish an equilibrium between the amino acid and the H+ ion. So now the amino acid will have a tendency to accept the H+. Right? So when amino acid is kept at a pKa lower than its, when the amino acid is kept at a pH lower than pKa of its side chain or amino acid of the alpha carbon or COH, then it will tend to accept the H+. Because medium has more H+. So it will try to attract the H+. So that the equilibrium is maintained between the medium and the amino acid. So this is a very important concept. And it will be used to know what exactly the net charge on the molecule will be and many other things. So I hope it is clear. So now let me tell you what are the pKa's of the various ions. So alpha carboxylic group or alpha COH, we know that it is present in the site. We know that this is alpha carbon, this is H, this is COH, and this is NH2, and this is R2. Now the COH, which is attached to the alpha carbon, direct main carbon. So this alpha carbon carboxylic group has pKa of 1.8 to 2.4. Now beta carboxylic group. We know that aspartic acid has a beta carboxylic group. Right? To this beta carbon, one COH was attached. So the pKa of this COH is 3.65. And gamma carboxylic group, that is gamma COH group, it was there in glutamic acid. Beta and gamma. Now a COH is attached to it. So the COH of this group is 4.25. So we can easily remember it. Let me tell you the pKa of all of them, then I will tell you the trick to remember. At least to have an idea of how to remember these groups. Now we will talk about alpha amino group or NH2. So alpha amino group is this one. So its pKa is in between 9 to 10. And of ypsilon amino group, we know that in lysine there was an ypsilon amino group. There was a long chain of carbon and then an NH2 was attached over here. Alpha, beta, gamma, delta and ypsilon. So this amino group has a pKa of 10.7. Now we have imidazole ring of histidine. The pKa is 6 and guanidinium ion of arginine. We know that arginine has a guanidinium ion. So its pKa is 12.48. Now let me tell you, since 7 is neutral, so that means the acids will have pKa less than neutral, right? Less than 7. Then only they will be acid, right? So they have less than 7 and amino group is basic. So it will have pKa more than 7. So all of them have more pKa, like 9 to 10, 10.7, 12.48, right? So that's how we can have an idea of pKa of various R groups. Now let us solve the problems related to pKa, pI and these R groups. Now this is the rule for determining pI or isoelectric point of simple amino acids. Like these are not peptides, these are free amino acids. So if the side group has an amino acid which is acidic, so we know that there are only two amino acids which are acidic, aspartic acid and glutamic acid. So in these kind of cases, what we do is we take average of pKa of R group. This is the R group, pKa of R group and alpha COH, and we do not consider the NH2 pKa. So we know the pKa of NH2 is 9 to 10. Let us take it as 9.1. The pKa of alpha COH is in between 1.8 to 2.4. So let us consider the pKa is 2.1. And of beta COH group is, how much was it? It was 3.65, right? So this is 9.1. But because it is acidic amino acid, so the rule is we take average of pKa of R group and only alpha COH. So we won't touch it, NH2. So let us do average. So pI will be 2.1 plus 3.65 divided by 2. So we take the average. So what will be that? It will be 5.75 by 2. Right? So let us do the answer. So the pI of an aspartic acid is 2.875. Now this was the case of aspartic acid. Let us consider the case of lysine. We know that lysine is basic amino acid, and the rule for finding the pI of basic amino acids is, like this between arginine or lysine, I am taking the example of lysine over here. We take the average pKa of the side chain, the pKa of NH2 and alpha amino group. Now we won't consider this COH group, we will consider this alpha amino group. So let us consider the pKa is 9.1, the pKa of it is 2.1. And what was the pKa of epsilon NH2? The pKa of epsilon group is 10.7. So simple, if we want to know the pI, we take the average of 9 alpha amino group, which is 9.1, and epsilon amino group, which is 10.7, divided by 2. We won't take COH 2.1, we won't take it, we will ignore it. So now let us do 9.1 plus 10.7, 19.8. It is 19.8 by 2. So it is, the pI is 9.9. So that's how we can find out the isoelectric point or pI of various amino acids. Let me make a table of pKa, pI, pKa of of other amino acids as well. But I won't make their structures. I will directly write the pKa and pI and find out the pI. Right? So let us do it now. I hope it is clear. Now based on the rule, let us do find out the pI of other amino acids as well. Like for aspartic acid and lysine we have already done, but still I'm writing it over here. Now I'm not making the structure. We know that we did average of 9.1 and 10.5 for lysine, and for aspartic acid 2.1 plus 3.9. So we left this one. Now let us do for glycine. We know that glycine does not have any R group. So it does not have any R side chain. So it has no third pKa. This is pKa, pKa3 or R. It does not have any. So we simply take the average of both of them, which is 6.1. Aspartic acid we already did 16. In the table, I only wrote the table which I made earlier. I only wrote the pKa of side chains of a few amino acids which are very famous. But the pKa is there for each other side chain. For 16 side chain of R group, the pKa is 8. So you can check it in the internet or any good book. You can find it out. We don't, the main pKa's are for acidic amino acids and basic amino acids. For 16 and all, they are not asked. But if you want to know, you can check in the internet or any book. Now for 16 is 8. Now as per the rule, when the amino acid is neither acidic nor basic, like tyrosine or cysteine, then what was the rule? The rule was we take the average of pKa of the alpha COH and the middle pKa. Now for cysteine, the pKa, one pKa is 1.86, another one is 10.5, and the third one is 8. Now the middle pKa is 8. Because 10.5 is extreme right and 1.868 is on the extreme left. In between, the pKa is 8. So we take the average of the middle amino acid, the middle pKa and alpha pKa. So 1.86 plus 8. So it is 4.93. Now for tyrosine also, we will do the same rule. The pKa of alpha COH group and the middle pKa. So 10.1 is on the extreme right. So this is in the middle, 9.1. So we take the average of 2.2 plus 9.1, which is 5.65, I'm sorry. And for lysine we already did. We take, because it is basic amino acid, so we take alpha NH3 or NH2 group and pKa of the R group of the epsilon amino group. So the average is 9.1. So that's how we can determine the pI or isoelectric point of all other amino acids. Now let us understand what is the net charge on an amino acid when it is kept at a particular pH, and also the pI of a peptide. Right? So now let us understand and determine what will be the net charge on this peptide, which is glycine, aspartic acid and glutamic acid, when it is kept at pH 1. Now the structure will look like this. This is glycine. It does not have any side chain, so it will have H group attached over here. This is aspartic acid because it has CH2COH group. Then after that, this is glutamic acid. CH2COH. So this entire peptide is glycine, aspartic acid and glutamic acid. So now, earlier I explained a rule, like when the pKa is, when an amino acid is kept at a higher pH, then what it do? It will lose the H plus. Right, but when it is kept at lower pH, then it accepts H plus. Right. So this concept will be used over here. So at lower pH, H plus will be accepted. If pKa is more and it is kept at lower pH, then H plus will be accepted. But if pKa is less and pH at which it is kept, it is higher, then H plus will be lost. Now let us consider for NH2. We know that NH2 has what pH? What is the pKa of NH2? It is 9.78. So that means pKa is 9.78. But this is kept at how much pH? 1 pH. So that means it is lower. It means it will accept 1H plus. Right? So when NH2 will accept 1H plus, it will become NH3 plus. So it has charge of plus 1. Right? Now we will move forward to aspartic acid side chain. So what is the pH? The pKa of C aspartic acid side chain is 3.86 and it is kept at a lower pH, which is 1. Now what will happen? The H plus will be accepted. Otherwise what COH do is COH will lose 1. It has tendency to lose 1 H plus. But since it is kept at a lower pH, so nothing will happen to it because H is already accepted by it. Right? So the charge will be 0. Now we will check for glutamic acid. For glutamic acid also, the side chain pKa is 4.07. Again it is kept at a lower pH, which is 1. So what will happen? COH will keep its H as accepted. So now there is no charge. So it is also zero charge. Now we will move towards this COH. What will happen? Again, the pKa is how much? pKa for alpha COH is 2.10. But still it is kept at 1 pH, which is lower. So H plus will remain accepted. So it will remain as it is. Right? So again the charge is 0. Now let us do a total. What is the total? Plus 1, plus 0, plus 0, plus 0. There are 4 us. So charge will be 1 plus. That means when we will keep this peptide at pH 1, that time this peptide will have net charge of plus 1. Right? I hope it is clear. So now let us calculate the net charge on this peptide at other pH, like at pH 6, pH 8. Right? Let us calculate at pH 6. Now let us see what happens. Now the pKa for this alpha NH2 group is 9.78. Again the pH is 7, so it is lower. So that means it will accept H plus. So again it will accept H plus and become NH3 plus. So the charge over here will be plus 1. Now let us calculate for CH2COH. Now this time the pKa is how much? है aspartic acid, it is 3.86, right? This time it is kept at a higher pH, which is 6. Now it will lose an electron. It will lose an H plus. It will lose H plus and it will become COO negative. So that means it will have a minus 1 charge. Now at pH 6, at pH 1 it was accepting COH, like H. So there was no net charge. There was no charge on it. It had zero charge. But now at pH 6 it will have minus 1 charge. Again, for this one also, the pKa is 4.07. 4.07, but it is kept at pH 6. So that means again the pH is higher. So it will H plus, it will lose H plus. So it will have minus 1 charge. Now we will do for COH. What is the pKa of COH? Alpha COH 2.10 and it is kept at higher pH. Again, the pH is higher. So again, the charge will be minus 1 because it will lose an H plus and it will also lose H. Right? So now we will calculate the net charge at pH 6. So net charge will be how much? Plus 1 from here, minus 1, minus 1 and minus 1. So the net charge is minus 2. Right? So that is for acidic pH, like less than 7. Now let us calculate at pH 8. What happens to the net charge when pH is 8? pH is 8 this time. Again, pKa is how much? For alpha NH, it is 9.78. But it is kept at pH, how much? Lower pH, which is 8. Again, the H plus will remain accepted and it will be plus 1 charge. Now for this one, pKa is how much? As per 3.86, but it is kept at pH 8. So it will lose the H plus. So charge will be minus 1. For glutamic acid, it will be how much? 4.07. It is exactly the same, like with a slight modification. It is kept at 8. So again, it will also lose H plus. H plus will be lost. For this one, alpha COH also, H plus will be lost. It is 2.10, but it is kept at 8. So it has minus 1 charge again. So same. The charge is again same, which is plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. It is minus. Now let us keep it at pH 10. Let us see now what will happen. Now it is at 10, so pK is 9.78 for this alpha amino group. So that will now it is kept at a higher pH, which is 10. So what will happen now is, now this NH2 will not lose any H+. Because now it will not accept any H+. Because this time pH is higher. Right? So when pH is higher, it is kept at higher pH, then H+ is lost. But that means NH3. It has NH3+, so H+ is, it will remain as it is. It is not going to accept anything because now it is kept at lower, higher pH than its pK. Again, for COH is same. Since the pH at which it is kept is 10 and pK for it is 3.86. So it will lose H+. So it will have -1 charge. For CH2COH also again, it is at 4.07 and kept at pH 10, which is higher. So H+ will be lost again. So it will also have -1 charge. And for COH also, it will lose the H+. So it will also have minus. Because for alpha COH, it is 2.5. Now let us, it will have 0 charge over here. So now net charge is slightly different. It is minus. So that's how we can find out the charge on a particular peptide when it is kept at a particular pH. So I think that's all for today. In the next video, we will find out what is a PI. How we can find out the PI of a peptide like this. Right?